Ignition sequence starts. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Liftoff. We have a liftoff.
Hey everybody, this is the Digital Asset Investor, and we're going to get going this morning. This guy right here from his name? CEO of FTX Official. He gives you a little bit of truth here in this video. I want you to watch this. They're talking about his climate pledge, but he tells you the truth about Bitcoin and Ethereum that we've been talking here on this channel for quite a while, even when people were attacking us for doing so. And now all of a sudden people are starting to tell the truth.
Transaction. Okay, tell us what you're doing, Sam. You're getting a good carbon zero. So go ahead.
Yeah. So, step one here is just offsetting the impact of the transactions that we do have. And, it's not free to do that. It's also not prohibitively expensive.
Still being done. I thought Bill Gates that buys carbon credits. $7 million means nothing to him. That doesn't make his 400,000 square foot house and his, two people on a Boeing 747 flying around. That doesn't make it okay when he decides he'll give $7 million to buy carbon offsets.
I agree with that, by the way. And for years, that's one of the things that has driven me crazy is watching these billionaires go on TV and talk about how they care about the climate and all this while they're flying in private jets and using 1,000 times more whatever to that hurts the climate according to them than any of us have ever thought about using. And then they create this scheme about carbon credits so that they can justify what they're doing. I have a problem with that, and he's 1,000% right about that.
I don't think that's the full long-term answer, but I do think that's a piece of it. I think that's the right first step, right? And it can't be the full answer because at some point you run out of other people's carbon to offset.
Right, exactly.
And so, but I do still think that it helps. And I think it's a responsible thing to do to mitigate to the extent you can the short-term impacts. I think the other side of this is that when you look at—
Here you go, listen up.
Energy uses of cryptocurrencies. There are only two major cryptocurrencies that have large energy usage. It's Bitcoin and Ethereum. Now they are the two biggest. The reason is that those are the two proof of work currencies. And proof of work is where all the energy usage comes from.
Ding, ding, ding.
Ethereum is transitioning to proof of stake over the next few years, which will make it down to just Bitcoin as a big energy user. And so I think that the other piece of this is when you look at the frequent transactions and payment rails, using chains for those, which have massively lower energy footprints. And already you're starting to see that transition towards faster chains, towards layer twos and other chains that are just built without energy consumption being the standard of measuring reward.
All right, a little bit of truth there. Now, it looks like yesterday I showed you the video of this lady here. Her name is Deidre DeBosa. Okay, she's the one that covered that interviewed the Tether executives. Now, Squawk Box is picking that up and wants to talk about it too.
Reports of a federal investigation into crypto stablecoin Tether moving crypto markets today. And Deidre Bosa has the latest. Deidre.
Good morning, Andrew. Well, scrutiny of Tether has been building for years, but the latest, according to Bloomberg, could bring criminal charges against its executives, marking the most significant crackdown yet on the crypto economy. Now, the DOJ probe into bank fraud reportedly focuses on conduct that occurred years ago when Tether was not used as widely. It now underpins more than half of all Bitcoin trades and has a market cap of $62 billion. Now, more recently, questions have been building surrounding Tether's reserves, which are not, in fact, backed one-to-one by U.S. dollars, as was earlier marketed, but majority by commercial paper. Last week, I sat down in a rare interview with two Tether executives and tried to get to the bottom of what that commercial paper included. Have a listen.
When you say international commercial paper, are you willing to give us any more details? Chinese commercial paper is thought of very differently as Canadian commercial paper.
As Paolo mentioned, we guard our counterparties' relationships with great discretion. We have a lot of sensitive information inside our companies as retail-facing as retail facing entrepreneurs. And we believe we've given sufficient transparency into that.
So no more details there. But Joe, the reason that this all matters is because Tether's current size, $62 billion market cap, may make it one of the largest commercial paper holders in the world. And Fitch Ratings has warned that a run on the crypto could actually destabilize short-term credit markets. And many have said that Tether could be the weak link in the crypto economy. Back to you.
Now, I commend CNBC for investigating this. It should be, but you shouldn't pick and choose what you want to investigate based on a narrative that you're setting in a boardroom, because that is what the news does now. And it is not just shameful, it's scary for democracy is what it is. And I set up here, I said, hey, Squawk Box, investigate the ties between Jay Clayton, William Hinman, and Ethereum. This story around Ripple case is the financial story of the century, and you're ignoring it. Your credibility is on the line. And I copied all these clowns in on this, and all of them have been ignoring this. And I also retweeted it again. And I said, when I was a kid, news outlets competed for viewership by getting the scoop on stories first. The truth mattered. The truth will set you free, CNBC. Now, this is so true because when I was a kid, you know, my understanding of the way the news worked is, you know, if you're a newspaper or a television station, you had to make a profit. And when to make a profit, you had to get the stories before the other people. You had to get more of a viewership, put people on with better personalities than your competing network or your competing newspaper, get better writers and do things that would make you a better network or a better newspaper than the other guy. Now, the way our news media works in the United States, I can't speak for other parts of the world, but it's very clear. They sit in a room. First of all, they have companies that are paying to continue a narrative instead of trying to make a profit. They've got big, huge companies, and they're sitting, supposed journalists are sitting in rooms, and they're being told what the narrative that they're going to push. Then they go out and push it. And then they only investigate the things that the people pushing that narrative want to push. That is a sad state of affairs. It scares me for my children's future. It's disgusting. It's very scary. And they ought to be ashamed of themselves. You'd think that just one person might grow a set and tell the truth. The truth will set you free, CNBC. Crypto Dim. Goldman Sachs applies for DeFi ETF. Now, I've said for a long time on this channel that I didn't think that these ETFs were going to start getting approved until the big boys stepped up and were ready with their ETFs. We've talked about that regarding Bitcoin ETFs a lot. Now Goldman Sachs applies for DeFi ETF. The filing joins over a dozen crypto ETF applications sitting before the SEC. All right. So I've told you for the last 3 years, it's not going to be one of these jackleg organizations that gets the first approval. It's going to be one of the Goldman Sachs white shoe boy type firms. And you'll never guess where Gary Gensler was, who's at the head of the SEC and will be the person who gets to approve or disapprove these. You'll never guess where he was for 18 freaking years. That would be Goldman Sachs. Where do you think his loyalties lie? Because Goldman Sachs and JP Morgan run the world, or at least the United States, really the world. So how do you think that falls down? And yeah, I'm sure they'll do the initial turn down so they can make it look legit, turn it down and then let it through the next time type deal. But make no mistake, nothing happens in finance without Goldman Sachs and JP Morgan. Camo Ammo. Coyle tweeted this yesterday. Pay attention. Now that catches my attention. I don't know what they want us to pay attention to, but they tweeted it and I wanted to show it. Now, I tweeted this yesterday. Standard Custody, which is a subsidiary of PolySun, had tweeted this out they're starting to tweet out all of their board members and executives it's their coming out party, I guess. And so I said, I was asking David Schwartz, any chance we can hear about some of that cool stuff now? And that was a reference to the video where he says this.
God, I really wish I could answer that, but I'm under a non-disclosure agreement with PolySign, and I don't, and because they're in stealth mode right now, I don't know what I'm allowed to tell you. Okay. I can tell you that they're in the custody business, and of course I can tell you that they're doing it like an amazing way that, you know, Arthur and I are behind this, we're the lead guys on the technology, and obviously like we're doing it, we think we're doing it right. Unfortunately, I don't know what. I really wish I could tell you because it's so freaking cool. I'm busting with wanting to tell people what we did, and they're like, "Oh no, we're still in stealth mode. It's still non-disclosure." So unfortunately, I cannot answer that question. But I feel really bad.
So that's what I was asking him: is can we hear about that so freaking cool stuff? Then I ran across this morning, just looking around at things. As you read this, remember the SEC doesn't see it important at all to talk to Jed McCaleb. To my knowledge, he isn't even being deposed. Oh, the stink. Now, I'm showing you this as a holder of Stellar. I mean, XLM. I own XRP and XLM. But the truth is the truth. But that isn't the last that Ripple Labs hears from Jed McCaleb. A few months after his departure, he returns with a foreboding post on XRP Talk. "Hi everyone, I started working on Ripple in the summer of 2011. I soon hired Arthur and David to help me. In 2012, I met Chris Larson. He joined us 5 months before Ripple was launched. Chris, Arthur, and I kept 20 billion XRP, of which 9 billion were mine. We gave the remaining 80 billion to OpenCoin. I have given away and donated some of my 9 billion XRP to charities." And then those are the charities. "I plan to start selling all of my remaining XRP beginning in 2 weeks. Because I have immense respect for community members and want to be transparent, I'm publicly announcing this before I start. So just FYI, XRP sales incoming." And then this person that wrote the article: "Now, in any traditional financial market, a post like this would probably fall under the guise of insider trading or at a bare minimum fraud." Huh? He's warning people he's going to sell. How is this insider trading or fraud? Now, I don't think you can have insider trading unless it's a public company. But my question is more, if the SEC thought that XRP was a security, you would think that, and it's not like they weren't aware of this. These guys in government, they're watching this kind of stuff. When there's this kind of money involved, these kind of amounts of money, you better believe they're watching. So you have to ask yourself the question, why would the SEC not be all over this? And then it says, but Jed doesn't go to jail and unsurprisingly doesn't sell his XRP, instead reaching a deal with the executives and board that he will, under a specific schedule and with limitations on volume, sell his XRP over the course of a 7-year period, which we're almost done with. Anyway, there's some other things. And then they go on to talk about how then the SEC ends up going after Ripple and doesn't touch him. Talk about fishy and something stinking. Okay, Jeremy Hogan, what are the chances the chair of the SEC, Gary Gensler, joins Twitter the same day that the director of enforcement, Gruhl, officially starts in charge of litigation on the day before the deposition of former director Hinman? Conspiracy theory away. Well, I will do that here, because if there is anyone who knows about what it is like to be constantly attacked on Twitter by people that I've never done anything but good for, and that by people that I've never been anything but nice to, it is this guy right here. So when I see what Gary Gensler literally opens himself up to, in his case, all kinds of abuse that's probably a lot more deserved. The day before Hinman's supposed to testify, to me, it looks like a guy who has shown up so that he can be a hero, not a guy that has shown up so that he can be bashed to pieces. So, craziness. But my advice to Gary Gensler about his Twitter account is, look, I've learned that people, out of pure spite and jealousy, will say all sorts of things about you to you. And about 99.9% of them will be lies, because that's another thing you got to learn about Twitter. It is chock full of liars and people who are miserable in their own lives that take it out on people on Twitter. It's full of them. So Gary, strap in and get ready. That's what's coming for you. But in your case, you're not doing the right thing with this Ripple case, and so some of it's going to be deserved. Okay, right here. Put this in the All the World's a Stage file. This is from XRP Darren. And, this is some kind of an Aspen. It looks like the Aspen Strategy Group is going to be having some type of presentation. Gary Gensler, the chairman of the SEC, is going to be the speaker. And he's going to be introduced by Anna Manuel, who's on the board of directors at Ripple, or as an advisor. I can't remember which one. And as another note, I think the Brooks Entwistle, as well as another lady who I think the CFO of Ripple, just joined the Aspen Strategy Group. You can't make this stuff up, and it goes in the All the World's a Stage file. Okay, Link2 had tweeted this out. Recently, CoinDesk announced that MasterCard is in conversations with Uphold to provide digital wallet technology. We look forward to more news on the subject soon. Uphold is available for accredited investors today on Link2. Now, this is from yesterday. They are out of Uphold. It sold out again. I bet it sold out, somewhere between 10 and 15 times if I had to guess. The only thing they've got, they sold out of Ripple, they sold out of Uphold. Uphold's my favorite investment that I have in private equity by far, because I think they're going somewhere. Now, I have some Kraken too, and there's some of that available on the platform. They've sold out of Ripple, and I don't see Link2 on here. But anyway, go check it out. These links are in the description. They are my sponsor, but I'm also a customer of theirs, because that's how I roll. I'm the digital asset investor. I'm not an investment advisor. This is for entertainment purposes only. Please subscribe, hit the like button, and tell your friends and family that Uphold is my favorite private equity investment, and this is how I roll. Thanks for listening.